Hello everybody. Today I'll talk and will demonstrate some code in Python about the blockchain cryptography for developers. And I'll touch many things like elliptic curves cryptography, things like the digital signature algorithms, the SegP256K1 curve, some hash functions, some wallets, AES, etc., etc. I'm Svetlin Nakov. I'm famous enough in Bulgaria, but for the external people, I drive the largest training centers in Bulgaria. The last three biggest have built by myself mainly. And we train maybe 100,000 of software engineers each year, of which 5% graduate. It's usual for these massive trainings. And all the industry knows me for the books, for the many things, but recently I'm involved deeply in the blockchain. I have successful ICO projects and many things in this sphere, and we're starting to train people all over the world about blockchain development, how to build things, how to build decentralized apps, things like that. I'll talk in some details about the elliptic curves, the heart of the modern public key cryptography, which will be shortly removed because it's not quantum safe, these elliptic curves, the error safe, things like that. But still, these are the most used cryptography systems in the blockchain, including in Bitcoin, Ethereum, and in the others. Only IOTA uses quantum safe signatures, and NEO says promise they are quantum safe and they are not. And most blockchain industry just lives on promises, you know this. So I'll talk about cryptographic hash functions, HMAC and key derivation, why we should use the correct parameters when you encrypt passwords in by SCrypt, how the AES works and how the wallets work, why BIP39 mnemonics and BIP44 hierarchical key derivations, and how we manage a single wallet with multiple keys and addresses, and how we encrypt these wallets. This is a big story because security in the blockchain is something which we cannot just keep because they will just stop our business. So let's start with the elliptic curves. How many of you know what elliptic curve is? This is some kind of equations. Math. But let's start with the public key cryptography. The public key cryptography is about public keys and private keys, about asymmetric encryption and signature algorithms. When we have a plain text, we can encrypt it using a public key, and we can decrypt it using the private key, or opposite. We can encrypt a message with the private key and everyone can decrypt it by the public key. The private key is known only by the user, by the wallet holder, for example, or Bitcoin account holder, and the public key is everywhere. It's considered that you cannot derive the public key, the private key from the public key. It is not true for the quantum epoch, for when we have good enough quantum computers, but these crypto systems will evolve and will change soon in the next few years. So, two major things: encryption and digital signatures. I will talk about them. And two big crypto systems, the RSA, the first massively used crypto system, which is still used in OpenSSL, in PGP, and big systems like this, and the elliptic curves, which is based on a better cryptographic and mathematical background. It's considered that 3072 bits RSA keys have the same cryptographic strength like 256-bit elliptic curve cryptography key. That's why the blockchain and the modern cryptography is elliptic curve based. And still, I repeat, this is not quantum safe. A good enough quantum computer will break this in a second. Just click break and it will display the private key. But still, it's believed that we don't have these computers. Only the aliens and NSA have this. So, let's go further, because the Bitcoin works on this elliptic curve cryptography. It's a system which works on such curves. This is called elliptic curve, and it conforms to equation like this. Specifically in Bitcoin, we have this equation. All Bitcoin keys stay on this curve. There are pieces of X and Y coordinates which conform to this equation. So all the public keys we use to prove that a transaction is sent by someone are based on this equation and are points on this. I will represent this better in this graphic. See, this is a discrete kind of the same equation. So we have points with integer coordinates which just pass into the grid, and these points conform to this equation, this one. But it's by modulus of certain number, something like 2 on power 256, something like this, very, very, very large field. So we here at the screen, we have a field 17 by 17, but it's very, 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 very large by square field. And some of the points stay here and they conform to this equation. This is the mathematics behind the elliptic curve called cryptography. And the points on these elliptic curves everywhere used every time you open a website and use SSL or SSH to some Linux machine, this calculation is made. And it runs through elliptic curve because it's better. Sometimes RSA is used, but it's considered old-fashioned and not secure enough because you need very long keys like 10 kilobytes to be secure. So we have, the major thing is that we have an integer K. It's called the secret key. It's 256 bits long key, randomly generated, which is your private key. When we multiply this by a point called generator G, we obtain a new point P, which is in the same field. And if it passes right to the left, it's translated back on the left side. It's the modulus P, the modulus. So generally, in the elliptic curves, the private key is integer, and the public key is a point. How many of you did know this? How many of you did know that you can derive your private key by the public key? If you have the private key, you can calculate the public key. This is not true for the RSA crypto system. This is true for the elliptic curves. That's why if you have the private key, you can calculate your blockchain address, your Bitcoin address, your Ethereum address, and many things like this. So it's very fast to calculate the multiplication of key by point, but it's infeasibly and extremely slow to calculate the backtick, to have division, to reverse this operation. And this is the main point of the security of this crypto system. And it's believed that the quantum computers will do this very fast by logarithmic time. Okay. So let's have some code. We install Bitcoin in Python. I'll write in Python because it's the easiest way to demonstrate this. So we can create this curve, the last one, 1707, the Bitcoin curve, but it will be on the field of 17 by 17. In Bitcoin, the field is very, very large, which can not be shown on the screen. And when we multiply this, we see that zero, if your private key is zero, your public key will be infinity. If your private key is three, your public key will be this one. Okay? Another interesting and important property is that this curve is symmetric. This is its properties. And when it is symmetric, if we have a Y coordinate, we have two or one or zero, but not never more than two points, which stay on the safe Y coordinate on the same vertical. That's why we can compress the private, the public key. The public key is point. If we have 256 bits private key, the public key is 520, 512. 512 bits of public key, and we can compress it. And next, when we use elliptic curves, we use certain curve. There are many curves, many different crypto systems that work on this framework of the elliptic curves. The most widely used, the most famous curve is this one, SegP256K1. This is called also the Bitcoin curve because Satoshi used this curve and Ethereum used this curve and most modern blockchains use this curve. It's a full of math, it's a definition of the so-called domain parameters along with security audits from cryptographers which say this curve is safe and there is no better way to extract the private key from the public key except just trying all the keys. It's not exactly the same. The best known algorithm is square root of n. Well, if you have a key n of size n, you need a square root of n operations to find the private key. On quantum cryptography, you have the same things but by logarithm. That's why it will take 1 second. So let me show you just a few things. There are many things described in this standard, which is considered some kind of deep mathematics. There are many conspiracy around it. It's believed that some people have chosen certain parameters because they can break these chiffres, things like that. But generally, we have curves which have different parameters, and these curves are described like this. For example, SegP192K1 have these parameters. These are the points. This is the field size, for example. What is n, the field, the square field, and things like that. I will not go into deeper details because they are too technical. I will mention the Bitcoin curve. It is this one. This is its graph, and these are the parameters. It's not so interesting, but you should know that we have 256 sized curves. We have bigger curves, which have bigger key size, with bigger field, and they bring better crypto properties. If you want to break a 512 bits crypto system, you will need more computing power. So let's map this to the Ethereum. How many of you have used Ethereum someday and know what Ethereum address is? So everything in Ethereum starts from a private key. The private key is the thing you have if you own an account in the network. If you have a wallet, you have private key. In most cases, you never see this key. It's not shown in clear text. But from it, the software makes the computation, multiplies the generated point by this key K, and obtains this public key. And it's long, it's twice as long as the original private key. And this is not good because each transaction should be more bytes. And this is this costs a lot because each transaction is stored in 10,000 machines or 20,000 machines over the world. That's why the key is compressed usually. So because of this symmetry, I showed a few before, they just add prefix 02 or 03, which says we have the upper or the down point on this vertical, and they save just the X point and skip the Y point. That's how it's compressed to 257 bits. And this is the usual format, which takes 33 bytes, which is not exactly 257 bits, but how we extract the address? We take the public key, we calculate a hash It's called HMAC 256. It's essentially HA3 with different parameters inside, different constants. And finally, we take the last 20 bytes. What does it mean? It means that there are a lot of private keys which maps to the same address. So if you are lucky and if you create a new wallet, you can just generate the same key like someone who has already some ethers. And you can steal the money. But today, we still don't know collisions. Nobody has found. And this, the difficulty of mining through the wallet addresses of the users is many times slower than mining for the normal proof of work hashes, which miners do in their mazeta. I don't know this word in English. In their garage, okay. So this is the address, and this is the important thing, that it's when we translate the public key into blockchain address, we lose a lot of information intentionally, because we don't want from the address to be able to recover the public key, to take a quantum machine and recover the private key and to steal all the funds inside. The same applies for the Bitcoin. So generally, hashing is quantum safe, generally, but elliptic curve cryptography is not. And quantum machines will not break everything. They will break some systems. So the digital signatures in the elliptic curve cryptography is this piece, RRS, which are 64 bytes. But most crypto systems add additional one bit, and they are able to recover from the signature the public key. I'll show you how this says. So let's write some Python. We install a pp package, ATH keys, and we can take this code. Ah, shit! Holy shit! No! This projector is broken. If I change the screen resolution, it breaks the everything. So this means that I will not show you any demonstrations, just slides, because I train people every day for the last 10 years and this never happens. But let me show you some code. So we import the ETH keys. Do you see? It's something like projector we have. We have this private key, this one, and we can print it, this one. Now we can extract the public key, and you can see the pub key. See, it's as twice longer than the private key, because it's a point. And we can compress this key like this. This is the formula we use. Generally, we take the y coordinate and divide it by 2. It is the second, and this is the compressed, which takes 257 bits, 66 hex digits. And finally, we can calculate the blockchain address where we hash the compressed public key and take the last 20 bytes, 40 digits, 40 hex digits. This is how the Ethereum addresses are calculated. But the most interesting thing are the digital signatures, because if I send some coins to someone, I need to sign it with my private key, and everyone on the net will be able to see that this transaction was signed by the private key holder, which corresponds to this blockchain address. And this is true for all the blockchains and ledger technologies in the world. But not all of them use this ECDSA crypto system. There are many other crypto systems. Some of them are quantum safe, but produce very long signatures. That's why they are not used today. There are some specifications, some maths inside, but generally in Ethereum, they use three things when produce signatures. This is the R and S numbers. R is a random number or number calculated from the message by some special algorithm. The S is number calculated through the private keys, by some formulas, and the V is the Y point of the point R described in RFC 6979. How this looks in practice, if we take this private key, okay, in Python, and if we calculate the signature for this message, sign this message, the signature is this thing. This is what an Ethereum transaction looks like. Something like this. But the message holds different text, not Zdrasti Pesho, but something different. Wow, Zdrasti Pesho is nice. So let me go further with signatures. Finally, we can split the signature in these three things. V, which says odd or even Y coordinate. R, which is some kind of hash-based calculation from the input message. And this is some encrypted data taken from the private key of the signer. And having all of this, you can verify this, this signature. I'll have it. I even have taken this one. Etherscan, do you know Etherscan? The largest monitoring service for the Ethereum network. And I have shown that this is my address. This is the hash which I calculated with this Python program. And this is the message. And it's verified valid. If I change something, it will be invalid. This is how the transaction signing in the Ethereum network and in the Bitcoin, of course, work. But Bitcoin encodes the addresses in different, not in hex, but in base 58 encoding. If we want to verify, see, if we have some message, if we have some signer address, and if we have some signature, we can extract the public key from this, which is not obvious. From the signature, you can recover the public key because you save additional information, because validating a signature requires the public key. What does this mean? This means that some days when we have quantum machines, if you sign a transaction to spend some to pay your bill, you will leave a signed message on the internet publicly. And this message can be taken and your public key can be recovered. From it, a quantum machine can derive the private key, which is not currently possible with the current machines, normal, and they will steal your money because they will send a high gas price transaction, high priority transaction, and will. But this will happen someday. Let me show you the key recovery and the verification of signatures. So we have this message. We have this private key. We recover from this library ETH keys the signature from this one, the same I showed in Etherscan. And we found the public key, which is the same one computed before, and the signature is true. If we just change one point here, for example, 5, it will say the signature is false. Of course, this is the properties of digital signatures. So what we have next? This was about the elliptic curves, but this is just the start. Let me proceed further into the cryptography. The easiest part, the hash functions. Everyone knows. Oh, hash function, MD5 is unbreakable. Not now. MD5 is never use hash function. It's still supported in WordPress, but only as a fallback. So, hashing is a transformational algorithm which takes some input and produces some output. But cryptography hash functions are one way, which means that if you have the hash, you can never produce a message which, when hashed, produces this hash. It's unreversible. It's infeasible to invert, and currently, there are no known inversions and collisions in the SHA-256 and in SHA-3 functions with key size 256 and 512. So it's extremely little chance of collision. Many systems believe that collisions are just not possible, like Bitcoin, Ethereum, and many others. If you are lucky enough, you can generate a private key, extract an address from it, and you can have a hash collision and have the same address with someone else who has different private key, and you have his money. This is how it works currently, and everyone believes that the chance to have a collision is so little that it's more likely that a meteorite will come and the Earth will disappear. The chances are better for this. That's why they believe that there are no collisions. So a few review of this: never use MD5, SHA-0, SHA-1, their collision found, and there are algorithms that someone could produce a signature without knowing your private key. This is proved, and these hash functions are bad. SHA-2 is still used and is still not broken. SHA-256 and SHA-512 is still good, but it's considered that SHA-3 is more secure because of the word from cryptographers. I'm not so expert to prove this. And RIPMD 116 is still collision resistant, but it will not be in the next few years because the hardware is more powerful and more powerful and more powerful. RIPMD 160 is still used in Bitcoin when you generate your address. And the modern functions like Blake2, Blake2S, and Check are still good functions, but they are a bit slower or have different things, and they are not popular. So, as of today, there is never found a collision for SHA-256, SHA-3, and these ones. There is no known two messages when hashed obtain the same hash value. If someone finds this by chance or by some research, he will be famous. That's why a bit about the cryptography. To break SHA-256, you need this number of operations for the best known algorithm. To break the same thing on a quantum machine, you need this one, because it's n by 3. So generally, hash functions are quantum safe. You just increase the key size and everything is okay, but not with the elliptic curves. And let's go further. Calculating hashes is not very interesting. I believe many of you have used this. Many systems take a document, calculate the hash, and use this as unique ID. It is almost unique, but is unique enough to be used in most systems. I will not demonstrate this because it's just hash calculation. How many of you have done sometimes a hash calculation? Most of you. Okay, let's go further. How many of you have done HMAC and know what is it and how it's used? How many of you know that your wallet software uses HMAC? How many of you know that if you encrypt your hard drive with a password, you will use HMAC? Because otherwise you will never know whether your password for decrypting your drive is correct or not. If you decrypt something by a wrong key, you will receive just wrong decrypted data. And you will not know that this is incorrect. Okay, what is HMAC? Hash-based message authentication code is generally a combination of encryption and hashing. You take a key, take a message, some hash function like HMAC 256, and you take a hash. Why we use this? For message authentication, to prove that the creator of this message knows some key. It's not so interesting, but it's used for the key derivation functions. Many of you have used some kind of encryption. For example, encrypting their Windows password or Linux password. They use encryptions, okay? But how But encryption is based on keys. It's not based on text. How to convert the text to a key? The word peso to some key of size 256 bits. And this is very important thing. There are many algorithms like HKDF, like PBKDF2, like BCrypt, like SCrypt, but due to the miners, it's very easy to break simple key derivation functions like just hash your, just take a SHA hash of your password. So people use mostly SCrypt because it's designed to be memory intensive. If you good use strong parameters for the SCrypt encryption, you may force your computer to use, for example, 16 megabytes of RAM in order to be able to perform the calculations. And modern ASICs don't have it. But let's start from HMAC. If we have this key, and if we hash this message, this is some kind of, let's say, combined hash, you can just append the strings and calculate SHA. But HMAC works differently in many iterations to make this more secure, and you get some key, some result. Let's say a few words about SCrypt. SCrypt is described in RFC, it's a wide standard, but it generally encrypts a password, but by given salt. This is usually a random. A random which comes from a secure random generator, because if it's not a random, this decreases the security. And it has three parameters, N, R, and P, and the expected derived keys, length which can be arbitrary number. So if we have this number of iterations by this size and by this parallel thread, we can just multiply these factors and calculate how many RAM will be required in order to decrypt this key. Why this is important? Because miners use ASIC devices. Do you know about this? Some machines like Antminer, which can perform, for example, 10 billion hashes per second. Which means that if your password is special, 5 words only, or Kiro, 4 words, it will break just start and it will show your private key or your password. So do you know about password cracking? Password cracking is just to try many times with different passwords in order to find the correct one. In the movies, it's always done for a few seconds. And password cracking, the SCrypt makes password cracking very slow. SCrypt calculation could take 5 seconds. In a good hardware, it will be 1,000 times faster. But this is good enough, because if you have 10 characters of password, your wallet will be never broken. Why this is important? Because if you have a wallet and you keep 10 millions of dollars in bitcoins inside, you will keep it somewhere on your hard disk or in some USB stick or somewhere else. There are hardware wallets. And if someone takes the file, he should either tell you, give me your password, or will try to crack this password. If it's not well encrypted with a good parameters of FScrypt or different algorithm, he can just break in few months on a mining hardware your password. That's why this is important. I will show you this in Python. This is how we just import some modules here. No, shit happens. Paste. And now I say encrypt this password with this salt, which is random. OS.URandom is considered a secure random generator which tracks your network packages, mouse moves, things like that to collect entropy and generate unpredictable random number. So my salt now is this text. And I can encrypt in SCrypt my key and derive a key by this salt. Why copy does not work? Shit happens, holy shit. this is my derived key. So from this password, I derived this key. But it takes time. See what happens if we increase the number of iterations. Wow, it's not possible for this, but we can increase, for example, to say this is 16. It takes more time if we increase furthermore this one, something like few seconds will happen. Okay, this implementation is not good, but generally you can, the time to calculate this key is increased by increasing these parameters and the memory consumption also. That's why it's considered that it's ASIC safe, which means if you have very good hardware, you still cannot reverse the password. If you have the file, my wallet file, I give you some JSON, you cannot reverse it. That's the concept behind the SCrypt. But only if you use good parameters, which is, causes unpleasant effect. Login, just wait 5 minutes and I will login you. So if you choose very big parameters, this will also not work. So the final thing I will talk about is the wallets, wallet key signatures. Generally, we usually in blockchain have some wallet master key, and most wallets are the so-called hierarchical wallets. And you have some mnemonic phrase, something like a long password. You derive your root key, the wallet master key. From it, you derive many private keys for many addresses. For example, in Bitcoin, it's considered insecure to use one address more than once. If you send some money from Pesho to Gosho, you send 10 to Gosho and return back resto change, a change on another address in the same wallet. So if you make 1,000 transactions, you will have at least 1,001 different private keys and different addresses which stay in the same wallet. So usually people have many addresses on the blockchain, not just one, because it's insecure, at least for quantum cryptography. And if you have the private key, you can calculate the public key, which is true for the elliptic curve cryptography and which is not true for the RSA cryptography. And from the public key, you can perform some hashing and calculate the address. Some blockchains use just this public key. If you have a transaction, you just generate Pesho, sends to Gosho 2000 bitcoins, for example. Pesho signs this by his private key and obtain a signed transaction. I showed this a little few minutes before. And from this transaction data and from this signature, they can calculate the public key, this one, and can verify that the signer address is correct, which means Pesho has the private key for this address and he is allowed to spend this money. This is how it works. And if we have a signed transaction, it can be verified by a blockchain address, which is not done directly. They first derive the public key, which is some kind of calculations, and they say valid or invalid. This is how Ethereum network works. This is how Bitcoin network works, and all their derivatives, like Bitcoin Gold, like Zcash, things like that. So let me tell you a few things about HD wallet, BIP39, BIP32, and the other standards. In blockchain, we have generally two standards for wallet. A wallet is a kind of file or storage or hardware device like this, which just keep my private keys highly encrypted. Highly encrypted depends on the Indian developer who have encrypted them. Most wallets have backdoors, have many privacy security issues, but generally, they are considered safe. So, simple wallets just keep a single private key. And it's highly encrypted. See what's inside. This is an Ethereum wallet. This is a wallet. Do you know this Mitre wallet? If you go here, you can generate a wallet. You choose some long password and generate. And it is saved in a JSON file. What's inside this file? We can open and we can explain what's inside. It's something like this. I have a better example, at least better formatted. Here, what's inside? It says, this is my primary address. This is the address which comes from the private key which is encoded inside this. This is the encrypted things inside, okay? But this is encrypted by some password. Password like #123 asterisk. And we use AES-128-CTR cipher. The padding algorithm is not explicitly specified, but it is PKCS7. And they have this salt. This is a random number. If I extract my wallet again, this file will be different because the salt will be different. This means that if I increase the same text twice with the same password, I will get different output. Otherwise, I can make a bug dictionary to say this text corresponds to this password and revert things if I have enough passwords. For example, if I am a Gmail, I have millions of passwords and I have can create bad dictionary from passwords to hash. But this is not possible in the modern crypto systems. This is very low. These parameters are very low, so crackers will be able to perform millions of checks per second. Millions passwords they will be able to check if they want to break this wallet. But this is generally what's inside a wallet. So this is the simple wallet, and we have also the so-called HD wallets, hierarchical. Oh, I have 5 minutes, okay. Hierarchical wallet start from something like this. I will explain it very, very easy by this demo. See, I can generate on enter the so-called mnemonic. These are words which are easy to remember, which you can write on a sheet of paper, which says that someone who takes your paper can just take a photo with his phone and your money are lost, which is a security issue, but they still use it. There is a variant to use a password in the same time. Usually they use 12 words, which has an entropy of 128 bits. From these words, they derive this so-called seed key. And from this, they derive, for example, Ethereum. We can take okay, let's take some coin, and we can derive the private keys like this, from it public key, and from it some address. And there is a thing called derivation path, which is just one string. We take the seed, take this, and perform HMAC. And we derive a keys. So you have a single wallet with a single initial secret words, but you can derive many addresses because you need it. When you send money, you take the change back in another address, in the next address. This is how it works. So the BIP32 standard defines how the crypto wallets can derive. This is complex, involves some math, some HMAC calculations, things like that, but generally you have a private secret, which is the source of your entropy, and you make HMAC and derive keys. How this works is how you transform this seed from seed to key is described in the BIP39 standard. But generally, if you have 12 or 24 words, you have this word list. That these words are from some dictionary, which is well known. This is for the English, the dictionary. So it's 11 bits. 2048 words have 11 bits of entropy encoded in them. So if you have a 12 words wallet, it have a strength of 132 bits. If someone wants to crack it, he needs to try this all possibilities. If you have 24 words like the Ledger Nano and the Trezor wallets, hardware wallets, you have more entropy. And this is how it works. Finally, the wallets are encrypted in a way I already show. AES, don't believe that AES is a black box which takes password and text and encrypts it. It's very complicated algorithm which involves the modes of operation like CBC, CTR, and things like that, the padding algorithm like PKCS7, the password derivation, which is very, 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 very important if you don't want your wallet to be broken if someone takes the encrypted file, and HMAC, which is used to check the password. So this is how we can make a AES. We generate some salt, which should be random. Here it's hard-coded, but it should be random. We usually use CTR or CBC to make the block shifter into stream shifter, because block shifters works on blocks of fixed size, and we need some padding and transformations like that. And finally, this is an example of a wallet. This is the encrypted private key, this one here. This is the algorithm used to encrypt it. This is the so-called initial vector, the salt. This is changed every time when we export the wallet. This is the key derivation, how our password, secret password, is transformed into the encryption key used for the AES. And this is MAC. If we don't have a MAC, if we decrypt the wallet with the wrong password, we will never know. We just will get wrong private key. And this MAC says it's some calculation by the hash and the private key and the piece derived from your password, which checks integrity and says yes or no, this description was successful or not. So for the curious people, there is some implementation in JavaScript in this link. I will explain this later because it's a lot of calculations here. So thank you for attention. And be careful when you write blockchain code, because cryptography is something. No time for questions?
Unfortunately not.
Oh, nice. I will be outside, so you're welcome. I'm very deep inside the blockchain technology, so we can discuss everything.
So next is building